Good afternoon. Welcome to this presentation by the Chamber Chorus. This is the sixth and final such presentation in this extraordinary pandemic series. And it's my great pleasure to introduce to you a good friend, colleague, former assistant conductor of the Chamber Chorus, Mary Chapman. Mary, thank you for being here.
Thanks for inviting me.
I'm Philip Barnes, the Artistic Director of the Chamber Chorus, and in this presentation, we're going to address some of the more unexpected or unlikely things that the Chamber Chorus has done in its long history. And so for that reason, we've called it Tales of the Unexpected. So the first piece you're going to listen to is an extraordinary work. It's great music, but it's extraordinary because of the libretto. It's called Italian Salad, translated into English. And it's by somebody who, by the look of his name, would be French, but it's actually German. And a 19th century critic, writer, and composer, Richard Genée. And I thought I'd ask Mary to just give us a flavor of the sort of lyrics that you'll hear and see, in fact, on the screen.
So in this piece, well, throughout this, you're going to hear me say that such and such was a lot of fun to sing, because the Chamber Chorus really is made up of a bunch of music nerds. So this piece has, what we were able to do is take words that we see in our music, like forte, fortissimo, parlato, you know, and we can sing them and embody them without giggling. So
this is basically, we're singing the directions.
Exactly.
So normally you get the directions telling you how to sing other words. Mm-hmm. This piece doesn't have any other words.
It doesn't have it, but we get to sing them.
So without further ado, we'll hear the Chamber Chorus now sing Richard Genée's Italian Salad, and it'll be featuring as our soloist, Nathan Ruggles.
So, Philip, we have done so many different pieces throughout the years. How have you ever had to celebrate something specific, like, I don't know, an anniversary or the Cardinals winning the World Series or a birthday, anything?
Well,
have you had to do that?
Just occasionally. Yes. Every so often, of course, people commission pieces of music for mm-hmm. celebrations. That's always a wonderful thing. And in earlier presentations this season, you've heard and been introduced to some pieces that were commissioned for friendship, for marriages, in memoriam as well, and Thanksgiving for teachers and this sort of thing. So that's certainly one of the reasons that sort of generates music. But once in a while, we ourselves, yes, get to celebrate the choir, because despite appearances, I am not as old as the choir.
What?
I know. So the choir is 65 years old. So when the choir gets to a sort of, you know, major anniversary, we obviously want to celebrate it. So I thought we'd hear now a rather extraordinary piece, which is by a former assistant conductor, mm-hmm. Stuart McIntosh, who's English like I am. And he was commissioned to write a piece to open the 40th anniversary season. So 25 years ago now. And this is such a brilliant piece of music because what it does, it plays to our strengths. There's something that I particularly like to do with this choir, and I've mentioned it in other presentations. I like pieces for double choir, and I very often like the idea of the two choirs almost having a conversation with one another musically. And I find that I like that. I think audiences find it really compelling and very intriguing because you're so used to going to a concert and hearing a piece of music, particularly if it's a choir, and they sing their piece and it comes over to you. And it doesn't require too many brain cells just to understand it and enjoy it. But there is something fascinating and bewitching, really, about two pieces happening simultaneously. So that's something I like to do with this choir, and Stuart knew that. And so what he decided to do was to celebrate the president of the choir at the time, who I know will be mortified if I name that person because she's very, very modest. But I'll just say that her name is Barbara, and her last name begins with a U, but that's as far as I'm going. Now, Stuart knew, and she's here today, and she's going to give me hell afterwards. But Barbara and I, and Stuart, we love folk songs. And so he found this wonderful folk song called Barbara Allen, which is from the north of England. Oh, yeah. And then there's another song that people traditionally sing at birthday celebrations. So here now is a piece from the 40th season called Birthday Celebration. And your job is to listen very carefully and see if you can guess and identify the second tune. Because as the choir sings Barbara Allen, the second tune starts to come into the piece. First of all, in the bass part, very slowly. And then bit by bit, it becomes clearer and clearer until then all bets are off. And we just launch into that second song. So this is a really great piece of music. It's a shame, really, that we don't get an opportunity to sing it very often. I guess we'll have to wait another few years for something like the 70th anniversary season. But here comes Birthday Celebration from the 40th season, arranged by Stuart McIntosh. Well, we've all heard that tune sung a million times, but perhaps not with that much gusto. The next piece we're going to hear is another one of those pieces that is not quite what it seems. This isn't for double choir, but there is a hidden tune in it. And I'm going to ask Mary to talk a little about her reaction to this when she first rehearsed it, and maybe a little about the hidden tunes.
Well, when we first got the music for this piece, I know that for many of us who have been singing with the chorus for many years, not nearly as long as you've been with us, but you start to learn how to translate Latin. And we got this and we said, Missa Sonus Musicae? Is that Sound of Music? And Philip said, why, yes, it is. So we all said, okay, well, it's New Music Monday. And for those of you who don't know, New Music Monday for us music nerds is like the best, because we get all of our music for the coming concert and we sight read everything. So we said, okay, let's do this. And this first piece, we're singing along and we went, is that doe a deer? A female deer? And he said, why, yes, it is.
So at least they knew the tune. So there's a very extraordinarily gifted man in London associated, I think, with the Royal College of Music called Michael Mullen. And in his darker or lighter moments, I really couldn't tell you which it is, he has communed with the spirit and soul of a long-dead nun in Germany. Everyone's looking as if this is the real thing. I hope you realize that people don't commune with dead nuns, but he says he's communed with a dead nun, and she had two great qualities. The first was that she was a celebrated jam maker, and the second was that she was a celebrated composer. So she channeled all the tunes in the Sound of Music and wrote this setting of the Mass. Now, this is a fantastic idea, and as you heard, the piece we're going to listen to now, the Kyrie, the opening, is based on Doe, a deer, a female deer. And all the other movements are based on different melodies from the musical. But before we get too carried away, we should remember that this was actually something that was done for real in the time of the fictional nun, Sister Veronica von Dieselheim. These things were called parody masses. And indeed, some of the greatest composers of the Renaissance took popular songs. They weren't even religious. And they elaborated the melodies into their mass settings. So although it's a bit of fun, it's also a very beautiful piece of music, and it would definitely stand up to a comparison with the best of Lassus or Palestrina. So Veronica von Dieselheim's Kyrie.
Thank you.
So we've heard on some of the earlier pieces that you've heard that we like to have fun. You've heard that we do different types of music. One thing that I love about this chorus is that no matter what Philip throws at us, well, not literally throws at us, but no matter what you give us, even if it's a little bit silly, we approach it with, we're going to make this sound good. And this next piece that you're going to hear from Z. Randall Stroope, who is very well known in the choral world as an excellent composer, he had the setting for a very familiar tune but we had to relearn this.
I know that I'm speaking to a group today of people with advanced degrees in Latin, so it doesn't really need too much explanation. And Mary has already said that singing in the chamber chorus over the years introduces singers to a fair amount of Latin. Mm-hmm. But just in case there's somebody out there who's not as familiar with the language as they should be, and of course for all the poor people watching through the streaming and then later on who have been culturally deprived, our wonderful custodian, if you like, a curator of this series with the images, Dan Hansen, has done a really amazing job of trying to show you through authentic works from the ancient mm-hmm. world how to translate this piece. So for those of you who are feeling a little nervous about being confronted with a lot of Latin, you're not quite sure how to translate it, you have Dan Hansen to thank for this sort of guide to this familiar song, but in slightly unusual lyrics.
Come on.
You could have used that as a drinking game, because somebody in the whole group at some point is going to go woof at the wrong time or leak. And if you went out of time, you're buying the drinks. It's actually, as is so often the case with humor, we know this not just in music, but in comedy, it's very difficult. And timing is everything. That is a very hard piece to do, as a matter of fact. Mm-hmm. And the next piece also has its challenges, and it's just intrinsically funny. But like Mary said, you have to take these pieces very, very seriously in order for the joke to work. And this again talks to my suggestion that this choir sounds so good and effective when it's doing two things at once. It's multitasking. So this piece is actually called Two for the Price of One. And it's two of the rather famous children's nursery rhymes. And I think this was actually before you joined the choir, is that right?
I think it was the year before.
The year before. Mm-hmm. So we got it in just before.
Yeah.
Because you can only manage one at a time.
Soprano.
Okay. I didn't say that. I just just repeated it. So this is by an English composer and choir director called Andrew Carter, who for many years was associated with the Chapter House Choir of York in the north of England. And his arrangements are really very beautiful and a lot of fun. So here is Two for the Price of One.
One of the things that is really enjoyable about the chamber chorus is that so often we become friends with the people who compose for us. And we have a very strong composer in residence program. And our first composer in residence is Sasha Johnson Manning, whom we all know and love. And she wrote this next song at the request of Philip, who came up with it on a dare. I'll let you tell him.
Well, thank you. So I like to put together themes of concerts, as all of you know, and I've forgotten what it was that I put together quite a few years ago that was a little unusual anyway. And one of the singers who we know very well said, you just put together themes on the craziest topics. You know, other people put together themes like Shakespeare or Easter or something like that. We do things like wrestling arenas. It's a little different. And so he said, let's see what you could do with this idea. We were having a meal after the concert, I think, at some bar, and I had pork chops. I remember that. And he said, okay, well, you can make a theme on anything. You're eating pork chops. Make a whole concert on pork chops. And of course, everybody laughed. I laughed. He laughed. What a funny comment. Should never do that. Just stored away. So every year, whenever I found a piece of music, a very unlikely piece of music to do with pork or pigs, I would put it in my little book and just go, this one would do. And eventually, would you believe, I had enough music, nearly, for an entire concert about pigs and pork. And you might think that this is full of really obscure composers that choral musicians have never heard of, but this is not the case. All these famous composers occasionally wandered into the land of the pigs. Percy Grainger, very well-known composer, wrote a piece called There Was a Pig Went Out to Dig on Christmas Day in the Morning. And then there's an amazing mass, setting of the mass. Now, you heard a parody mass a little while ago on The Sound of Music. There's actually a mass by Orlandus Lassus based on the song about Martin taking his pig to market. So we could put together all of these many, many, many different pieces of music, all to do with porks and pork and pigs. But we were missing the vital ingredient. Now, you can store that away to one side. Here's the next story. Sasha Johnson Manning has indeed been our composer in residence. She started in the late 90s. She was our first one. After she'd finished her official residency, she has carried on writing for us at our request when we're able to commission her. She's a fantastic composer, and she loves this choir because they take her music seriously. Even if it's funny, they take it seriously, and they do their best to give it a really first-rate performance. And that's probably one of the reasons why many composers love this choir, because they know that it's going to be performed, their music's going to be performed with great passion and commitment, and not in any perfunctory way. So, Sasha, at one point, again, she was over here for a premiere of her piece, and she, after the concert, we were having dinner, I don't know if I was eating pork chops then, but she said, I love this choir. And I go, that's great, we love your music. And she said, I'd write anything for your choir. And I went, anything? And she goes, sure, what could be difficult? So then I found that there's this very extraordinary story about a piece of pork, the invention of a piece of pork, a recipe that I love. And it's a Chinese pork dish. And those of you who like Chinese food will know that pork is a central part of Chinese cuisine. And this is the very fatty, but very, very flavorsome belly pork, basically. And it's cooked twice. And it's called Dong Po pork. So I thought, okay, what we're gonna do is instead of one of those boring concerts where everybody gets a free glass of wine in the intermission, you know, the wine that you would never pay for, they give it to you free, it's awful wine, and you sit there before the concert's going to resume. We're not going to do that. We're going to have a concert at which, in the intermission, there's free pork. Your ticket includes some free bacon. How many of you ever seen that? So I arranged that with a good friend of the choir, the wonderful Jane Gilbert, who can cater and cook just about anything. And so this was all arranged, and then I went to Sasha and I said, okay, here's this amazing story about this belly pork. And I'm ashamed to say, I wrote a little poem for her to set to music, because she said, you'll never find a verse about pork belly. And I just so happens I have one here. So I gave it to her, and I knew that this was meant to be when I realized that Dong Po pork, and you'll find out on the little presentation what Dong Po means, but I realized that Dong Po pork was first invented, according to legend, during a dynasty of a particular set of Chinese emperors called, get ready, Song. S-O-N-G. And so the title of this piece is In the Land of Song, but it's not any song that you're familiar with. So Sasha Johnson Manning's In the Land of Song for double choir. So, rather a great piece of music that, I think, commemorating an equally wonderful dish. We go on now to another commission from another British composer, this time not for pork, but maybe something that goes well with pork, and that is ale. And this is one of a set of songs commissioned for us from the composer Robert Walker. And these pieces were all commissioned to be sung at one of our performances that we gave at the Schlafly Brewery taproom. And I will hand over now to Mary for a reminiscence of what it was like to put together Good Ale.
Well, Robert was here when we premiered this, and he was just taken with this chorus. He still talks about us in a good way. But this piece, when we first read through it, I was absent that night, and you had said, okay, everyone with Scottish ancestry, raise your hand. So people would raise their hand. He said, you are in choir too. Then when I showed up and he goes, you're in choir too. I said, okay. He said, because all people of Scottish ancestry is going to be doing this part. I said, I am not Scottish.
And I said, but you are Scotch by absorption.
So this piece marks our debut for the second chorus as bagpipes.
So yeah, they had to impersonate.
We had to impersonate bagpipes. And Robert said, I love it. I'll have to write more music for bagpipes.
I'll let you be the judge of whether he should write any more. This is Good Ale, words by Robert Burns.
Good ale comes and good ale goes.
So this next piece that we're going to hear by a gentleman named Mario Castelnuovo-Tedesco is a beautiful piece for chorus and classical guitar. During your sabbatical, we had guest guitarist, the Hanser-McClellan duo, which is a fabulous guitar duo. And this beautiful piece is from a larger work called Romancero Gitano. And this is the Ballad of the Three Rivers.
Thank you.
So what's unexpected about that piece? Well, in recent seasons, in recent years, you'll know that we have typically performed a cappella. It's sort of our calling card. But the choir was actually founded to perform with instruments, with an orchestra. In 1956, Ronald Arnatt founded this group as the St. Louis Chamber Orchestra and Chorus. And it wasn't until the end of the 1970s that the orchestra departed, and we were left with the name Chorus instead of Choir. And in my tenure with the choir, we have done increasingly more music without accompaniment. We've specialized in a cappella music. But there are times when it's great fun and unexpected to collaborate with other instrumentalists. And you're going to hear quite a lot of that in our coming season, the 66th season, which is going to be, again, a bit unexpected, but a lot of fun, I hope, and an opportunity for us all to sort of count our blessings and working together to present really wonderful music. And so that little piece of choir and guitar music reminds me to point that out to you. Well, another unexpected element to the choir are some pieces that we performed that you might actually never hear. We perform them in another venue, in another form. And the next piece is one of those. So I'm very excited for you all to hear this piece, because I can guarantee just about that you have never heard it before. This is a piece that we recorded about 3 years ago, I think, just over 3 years, for a wonderful movie composer called Trevor Jones, originally from South Africa. And we had worked with Trevor before, recording a piece of music that he used on a television miniseries. Tell us a little about that.
So that miniseries was called Labyrinth, and it was based on the novel written by Kate Moss. And it was a story about
Cathars.
Yeah, the Cathars in the south of France.
South of France.
Yes. So, but also about the Holy Grail and, you know, the bloodline of Jesus. And we sang Psalm 23. So a bunch of us would watch to see where this was going on. And he had written Psalm 23. It's rather austere. And during that movie, we're singing this beautiful piece, and the Cathars are being thrown into the fire. And we all went, ew.
Yeah.
So we had high hopes for this next movie.
You never know what your music is going to be put to when you're working in the movie industry. Mm-hmm. So this next piece, as I say, you will never have heard, we've never performed it in public, just because I haven't found exactly the right occasion for it. It's a great piece of music, actually. And it was written for the part of the soundtrack to this movie, which is called To Tokyo. There's a misprint on your booklet for those of you in the room. It's called To Tokyo. And it's a remarkable film. And if you would like to watch it, it's now available on Amazon Prime. It's taken a long time for it to all come together because it's one of these independent films. Mm-hmm. It's put together by a very, very talented, very clever producer, director, and writer called Caspar Seal Jones, who is, of course, the son of the composer, Trevor Jones. And it's taken, as I say, quite a while to put all of these different elements of the movie together. But it's now done. Now you can watch it. So I went and saw it. I'm not sure what I was expecting. We knew nothing about what this film was, except that Trevor had said, I loved what you did with my Psalm 23 for Labyrinth. Here's another project if you'd be interested in it. So I will tell you, for those of you who are film buffs, there is a very famous film by Fellini called Satyricon, which is a very, very odd film and has a lot of what we might call atmospheric scenes in it that are almost otherworldly. And this film is straight out of that genre. It's only about 75, 76 minutes long. And there's very, very little dialogue. I'm not really selling it, am I? But it's really quite an extraordinary movie, actually. And the story you pick up as you go through the movie. It's not one of those movies, very simplistic, where they tell you everything that's going to happen. It's not like that at all. You're observing what's going on to the characters. It's all set in rural Japan and then in Tokyo itself. And in some ways, and if I haven't sold it yet, this probably will put the nail in the coffin. In some ways, it's actually a horror film, but it's a psychological horror film. It's not a film with blood and guts everywhere. The horror in the film comes from what you imagine is around the corner rather than what you see. So in many respects, it's a very old-fashioned sort of horror film. I'm watching this film thinking, well, okay, it's very, very beautifully photographed. I mean, it should win. It has already started to win awards, and I can't believe that one of those awards won't be for the cinematography. It's very beautiful. But I keep waiting and waiting and waiting for our part, you know, and we're getting to like 40 minutes into a movie that's only 75 minutes long, and we are nowhere to be seen. And there are other people singing in other scenes, and I'm thinking, you've got to be kidding me. We put together all that work one cold night in like February or January in a church with recording engineers, and we were all over the place. You know, everybody has their own microphone, and the whole thing has to be mixed and then sent electronically to the mixers in England. And I'm thinking, we went through all of that just to end up on the cutting room floor. Because we're not in the film. But I keep watching, and about minute 47, if you want to remember that, minute 47, the soundtrack starts to have a repeated melody or motif in it that I think, oh, wait a minute, that's the piece. That's not us. Those are instruments. But they're playing that music. And then bit by bit, it sort of gathers like, you know, crescendo. And we're still not in the film. By the time the young woman gets to Tokyo, we're not in the film. And the whole thing ends, and I'm not going to spoil the ending for you if you want to watch it. It's really quite something to watch. But right at the end, the denouement, if you will, of the end, when the screen goes black and then you have the credits, it's us. We provide the soundtrack to all the credits. And if you know about movies, you know the credits go on forever. Because so many people are involved in making a movie. So they took our recordings and they manipulated what we had done and expanded it and did all sorts of very clever things with it. So it is actually very, very powerful indeed. Much more powerful than I think any of us realized. But it's one of those classic things that you have to start at the beginning and work through it all in order to get the dramatic impact at the end of the music. So without further ado, here is from the movie To Tokyo, and what an appropriate title, My Dream, or could it be Nightmare, My Dream Goes On. So that's the very, very atmospheric conclusion to a very atmospheric film, To Tokyo, by Caspar Seal Jones, and the music was by Trevor Jones. So that was an example of us doing something a little unexpected for a classical chamber music ensemble, reaching out into popular culture and providing some part of the soundtrack to a movie. To the next piece of music is also maybe something you wouldn't associate with us, and that is country and western music. Now, Mary, of course, has advanced degrees in country and western music, but even she didn't expect to hear this piece sung. It's a work by the Nashville songwriter Gretchen Peters. And we heard earlier in our presentation the birthday celebration arranged by Stuart McIntosh. This is also arranged by Stuart McIntosh. I think it demonstrates just what an incredibly gifted arranger he is. And the piece is called On a Bus to St. Cloud, Minnesota. And the genesis for this piece, which is really a ballad, you know, country and western, as you have taught me, Mary, on many occasions, country and western is all about ballads. They're telling a story. And the genesis to this piece is that I was taking a very long flight overnight somewhere, probably Europe. But it was in the days when I didn't really have my own, I wasn't listening to music on my phone or anything like that. I was just listening to the music the airline was providing. And as those of you who have done those long flights will know, classical music is very badly served by those airlines. It always sounds horrible on the ears. So, but popular music can actually sound quite good because they compress the signal. So you actually get a certain, it sort of suits the background white noise of a plane. So I had these earplugs in, listening to something like contemporary music, whatever it's called. And I was about to drift off to sleep when I heard this piece sung by Trisha Yearwood at the time, who had made this piece more famous than the songwriter had. And I thought, what an incredibly beautiful song. And then I drifted off to sleep. And about an hour later, I sort of drifted back into consciousness, only to hear the song again. Because, you know, those of you who have done these long flights, you know you often sleep fitfully. You don't really attain good sleep. So to cut a long story short, or a long flight short, nearly every hour I woke up and listened to this piece. So by the time we touched down, I was completely obsessed by this piece. You've probably heard of things called earworms, a thing you just, a tune you can't get out of your head. You know, it's terrible. And that's what happened. So a little while after this trip, I was back and I was talking to Stuart and I was saying, there's this piece of music, I cannot shake it out of my head. Is there any way you could arrange it for choir? I just have an odd feeling that it would really go well for a choir. I know it's country and western, but... So Stuart, as always, sort of said, I love a challenge, get me the music. So we approached the composer, and these things are not supposed to be possible. You know, you're not supposed to be able to pick up the phone and speak to Elvis or somebody. But I found out how to contact Gretchen Peters. And to my delight, she was very happy to hear about that we were interested. I don't think many people are calling her for permission to arrange her music for choir, which, by the way, is a big mistake, because she does write the most wonderful pieces that would go well for choir. Anyway, she gave her permission, we got the permission, I gave it to Stuart, I gave the song to Stuart, and later on, this is the result. So it's a very beautiful ballad, On a Bus to St. Cloud, and before we listen to it, Mary, you're a soprano.
Yes.
Tell us a little about the quality of the voice of the soprano on this recording, because they're all different, aren't they? Also.
So, the people who sing in the chamber chorus, we all do different things. You know, there will be voice teachers, there will be engineers, neurologists, cardiac surgeons, stockbrokers, you name it, we all do different things. And a lot of us sing in very different styles. You've got opera, you've got pop, you've music theater. Well, the woman who is doing the solo in this piece is Nancy Lutzow, was a former member of the chamber chorus. She's also a member of a jazz group here in St. Louis called Java Jived. And in this piece, her voice fits perfectly because she's got that jazzy, folksy style going on in the solo. And it just sets so well with this piece. It really does.
So Nancy Lutzow and the chamber chorus performing the music of Gretchen Peters, arranged by Stuart McIntosh.
Thank you.
Well, after the movies, after country and western, what comes next? Well, yes, quite right. American goth. Well done. I'm glad somebody was paying attention. American goth music. So you can find wonderful music in the most unlikely places. If you have ears to hear, you've got to keep listening. People sometimes have said to me over the many years, where do you find this stuff? Well, the answer is you just have to keep listening. You have to keep looking, and you'd be amazed what you find. I was teaching this poem, Frater Ave Atque Vale, Brother Hail and Farewell, that is a very poignant poem by the Roman writer Catullus about visiting the grave of his deceased brother. And I was hoping to sort of show my students maybe a picture of where they grew up in northern Italy, the brother and Catullus, and on Lake Garda. And in the middle of doing all this research and trying to find things that I could show my students, I happened upon this setting. Total happenstance, this, because contrary to what you might think, Mary, I am not a devotee of American goth music.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But here is this piece of music in the middle of a lot of stuff that I wouldn't necessarily like. Incredibly beautiful piece of music put together by an American duo who go by the name of Faith and the Muse. And the Muse is Monica Richards. And like Gretchen Peters, once I'd found out how to contact Monica, she too was amazingly warm and generous and very flattered that we wanted to sing her music. Because a lot of music in that genre, American goth, a lot of popular American songs, they're actually written and performed by the one and the same person. So for somebody to approach them and say, you know, we really like that song of yours, can we do it as well? That doesn't happen every day. So she was very generous and let us do this. So you're going to hear a very short but beautiful setting. We haven't really arranged it at all. This is Monica's own music, and we haven't done anything fancy to it. And it's a setting of a wonderful poem, not by Catullus, but by an English composer 1900 years later, Alfred Lord Tennyson. And it concerns the idea of rowing out to a place on the lake called Desenzano. And it's all a reference to this wonderful lake in the northern Italian Alps. And sometimes the waters are called Lydian, because of a reference to where the original settlers came from in Asia Minor. So I think you can't fail but be charmed by this work. Monica Richards, Frater Ave Atque Vale.
So we've covered, as you said, bagpipes and now American goth, and we've had country western, and we've had movie scores. What comes next? Rock, right? So Bono, the lead singer for the group U2, wrote a beautiful piece called MLK in honor of Martin Luther King Jr. And British composer Bob Chilcott then set that for chorus. So you'll hear this paired, leading directly into the American spiritual, There Is a Balm in Gilead. This hymn was one of the pieces that Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. would listen to or sing to whenever he was imprisoned, because those are the song, that was one of the songs that he grew up with. It's one of the ones that gave him succor when he would be arrested, when he was being, you know, when he was being mocked and degraded. And hearing these two together are such a strong statement about the human spirit, but also him and what he gave to all of us. So what we're going to listen to now is our recording of MLK, written by Bono and U2, arranged by Bob Chilcott, and then going into the William Dawson arrangement of There Is a Balm in Gilead.
And we'll feature on the U2 song our colleague and friend Andy Jensen,
yes,
who will be the tenor soloist, and also in the Dawson. So, as you say, these pieces back to back by U2 and William Dawson.
So let it be.
So now that we've covered the rock portion of this, goth, rock, country, western, parody masses, you know what's next?
Has to be Barry.
Barry Manilow! So the way this came about for, you know, Barry needed to star with somebody, so he said, oh, okay. Philip got a phone call. Was it a phone call, right?
Yeah,
you got a phone call inviting us to sing with Barry Manilow on his farewell tour, which ended up not being his farewell tour. And Philip called me and he said, I just got the strangest request for us to do a concert. I'm like, okay, that's not weird. He said, with Barry Manilow. And I said, we have got to do this. And he said, are you serious? And I'm like, oh yeah. I said, you will have so many people wanting to do this. And we did. It was almost the entire chorus and extras.
And also extras.
And extras.
Yeah, so the one thing I've learned nothing else, over 30 plus years with this group, is that always expect the unexpected. And when somebody calls you up, it's not necessarily a prank call. If you've been following today, you've realized the very unusual and odd places and pieces that we've sung, and the extraordinary opportunities that we've all been given. And so, yes, this is really the icing on the cake in many ways.
It really is.
And there have been others, but other bizarre and extraordinary experiences for everybody. But I thought that this one would really sort of cap this very bizarre season of music in a time of the pandemic with a piece and a performance that I don't think any of us saw coming. And if it were not for our friend, again, Jane Gilbert, I believe you said, mm-hmm. who had provided the pork treats when we had the pork and pig concert, if she hadn't been in the audience with her trusty cell phone, I'm not sure that we would have had this memento of this great cultural occasion, the meeting of two musical giants, Barry Manilow and Mary Chapman and friends.
So before we cut to this, Philip, I have to tell you that, you know, active on Facebook, when I put down on Facebook, singing with Barry Manilow tonight, I think that was the post that had the most likes out of all of the posts that I've ever done. But do you want to learn some of the moves?
No, thanks.
Oh, come on.
No, I prefer it to, like so many things that are great in life, I prefer something to remain a mystery. So, see what you think, and if there's going to be dancing in the aisles, Mary is the person to guide you. Here's the chamber chorus, and this is just a little bit of the concert, of course. This is the end of the concert, and we've just taken a little sample of the choir backing up with the noise, the immense noise in the Scott Trade Center. There is actually one moment when you can truly hear the choir, I'm glad to say.
A little bit.
You can actually hear them. And here they are backing up the Lord of Pop in his epic piece, Copacabana. if back in 1989, when I started with this group, you told me that we would end up backing Barry Manilow, I'm not sure I would have, I would have taken the job. Of course I would have taken the job. I wouldn't have believed you, but I would have taken the job. And there have been so many unexpected pleasures, joys, privileges in these years, and it's been a great pleasure to share just a few of them with you this afternoon in this presentation. Of course, again, if you told me that we would spend an entire season in a sort of lockdown, revisiting and looking again at past recordings that had lain dormant for so long, I don't think I would have believed you on that either. But one of the great benefits of this peculiar and challenging season has been the organizing of our archive, which is, for me at least, a great personal comfort. The idea that 30 plus years is now archived of sound recordings and will be available to my successors and your successor. So that's one of the good things to have emerged from a season in which we haven't been presenting new music, but we've been looking back at some of the wonderful pieces in the past. So fingers crossed, everybody, and let's hope very much that the next time we all gather, it will be for performances live and in person. One of the concerts next year will be here in this wonderful church, and there will be some surprises in store for you for that 66th season as well. So the surprises are not ending this afternoon. It just remains for me to say on your behalf and on behalf of the choir a great thank you to Pastor Tommy Simons and the congregation of this Third Baptist Church in Grand Center, and to all the people who have made this series possible and made it such a pleasure and a success. I'm so pleased that we've been able to do this for you all. I thank very much our good friend Professor Dan Hansen for this extraordinary series, these montages that have brought alive these musical samples for us. And of course, I thank In the Booth, Hannah Gallup and Brent Johnson for making sure that everything went smoothly and that we have the sight and the sound when we want them. And to you also, thank you very much for your support through this year. And let's look forward to post-COVID and post-pandemic and music performed live. Thank you very much.